Hello guys, so are you enjoying PyCon Thailand so far? I would really like to thank and appreciate the PyCon Thailand organizers. They have been immensely helpful to me from like starting the selection of my talk for me to being here. Thank you so much guys, I am looking forward to do it every year. Okay, so I'll just introduce myself briefly. I am Kajal Puri. I work as a data scientist in Fractal Analytics, Bangalore, India. I just graduated last year and I have been doing internships and freelancing work in data science from third year of my college. Like that's pretty much about me. You'll get to know more. All my handles are on this page. So if you want to like talk to me, you have any other questions, you can ask me like after the talk or maybe you can contact me online here. I'm going to present the object detection with YOLO in Python. I have done a very small project at my work regarding this. So I'll just start right away with it. I'll just start with object recognition versus detection problem. As we all know that in computer vision, this problem is coming mainstream and we have been seeing focus on this since like we have been introduced with the deep learning technology. So basically people often get confused with object detection and object recognition. When I started with it, I thought like it's the similar thing and you know it's just they're like synonymous to each other, but actually they are different. So let's start with object recognition. So in this kind of problem, the machine algorithm tries to identify the different types of objects in the given image or a moving video. This is also termed as object classification or object identification. We have like multiple names for it. In this problem, we mainly just identify the object, nothing more than that. Whereas in the object detection, we identify the object as well as the location of, you can say the location, the coordinates, the position of the object in the image so that we can know where is it located. So basically object detection becomes the combination of object classification and the localization of the object which is associated with coordinates. So yeah, this is the example of object classification versus detection. In the classification problem, we can see that we have an object. It is being classified as that. But whereas in object detection, we have multiple different objects and they are identified as cat, dog or duck. So you can also see the surrounding bounding box in object detection problem, which makes it more difficult as well as interesting at the same time. So in object detection, we generally answer three questions. The first question is what? Like it's a classification task. Like what different objects are in the image? In this classification, there is just one object, cat, but it can be more than that. The second question that we answer is the localization. Where object in the image. So in object detection, we combine the what and where and answer this question. So the difficulty of the task increases as we go from top to bottom. Like what is an easy question to detect? it has been it can be detected by using pre-trained of so many deep learning architectures we are seeing these days, like Inception Net, VGG Net, or something like that. But the localization task has not become trivial, but it is becoming difficult over the time as we have more objects in an image. So it is difficult to locate their type as well as location. Yeah, so this image describes the object detection part by part. So basically what we were using previously, that were not giving us good results. So I'll just explain it very briefly. So what we were doing previously, before coming of deep learning era, is we used to take an image, a very simple image. We can do pre-processing on it, like you can you can change the color, you can maybe represent it into matrices or any other way. Then what we used to do was, we had some pre-trained classifiers, and we used to extract the feature from them and map on the pre-processed image. Then we used to apply some machine learning algorithm, maybe like support vector machine or neural networks or random forest, to classify them. Basically, these machine learning algorithms are used to study the features of the object or any other problem and classify them into the different categories. So and we used to assign them the given label. So I'll not give detail into this thing. The reason that YOLO has come is because of its fast processing and very simple procedure for it to train. Before it, there was fast RCNN, or there was hard classifier, HOG, descriptor. All these are classifiers you can find OpenCV library. Even nowadays, these classifier can be used to train on very small amount of data set, and if you have like good quality of pictures. So yeah, so basically this is the comparison of fast RCNN and YOLO, and like why YOLO is preferred, I'll tell you in my next slides. So yeah, I just quickly want to insert this topic, because I have done it at my like work, and I find it really interesting, and I think this is going to be a huge thing. This is already a huge thing, but yeah, maybe much more of it. So TLD. So TLD is a different methodology. So what it does is, it tracks the object and learn its appearance as the video progresses. So what it does is that it uses the pre-trained weights on a learned classifier. Can like use hard cascade, HOG descriptor, all you can find in OpenCV. You can also use like pre-trained weight of deep learning architectures like VGG net or Inception net or any other. And then you can use those pre-trained weights and learn more about the object as it progresses, as the video progresses. I'll just show you one example of this. So yeah. So basically, how it is different is that generally, when you are learning to recognize objects, you can see that there are different types of cats, right? Like even humans, as a human, we are like very different from our basic anatomy is same, but our whole structure, color, the way we dress is very different. So our main objective for machine learning algorithm is to detect the person in whatever form possible, in whatever form possible in a given video or an image. So the orientation, the color, the like a lot of things matter. Like even if it's in 2D or 3D. So in this moving video, you can see that the object is being recognized by a pre-trained, using the pre-trained weights of a classifier, and the video is moving, but it's not going to change the learned category of the object. So I find this really interesting. Yeah, so although this has like really big one problem, so what generally happens is that we do not have that much data sets when in real life when we are processing like real time processing, like even at my work the data set was very small, the pictures was not of good quality. So this problem only works when there is a good representation scheme of how the objects looks, because then only it will be able to detect and locate the object correctly. So I think that is why it's not being used much, because of this high quality image problem. But yeah, if you have that kind of data set, I think this is a very good algorithm to start working upon. So the reason that its name has been derived can take study from this cyclic graph. So what happens is, we start from detection. What happens is that first it tries to detect the using pre-trained weights or vectors of the given architecture, and simultaneously it keeps learning that the object is same by viewing it from different size or shapes or colors or maybe 2D or 3D differences also. So yeah, I think there should be more research on this this algorithm, because it's like really useful. Yeah, so now we'll come to our main topic, which is YOLO. So the reason, so the full form of YOLO is you only look once. Earlier the problem was that every object detection algorithm was seen as a classification algorithm. Nobody looked at it like a regression problem. What used to happen that in a given image, they used to represent in some matrices or a grid of plane, and then they used to slide a window on each frame and then apply the classification problem on it. What YOLO does differently is it sees it as a regression problem. Yeah, so I'll just explain this image for you. So what's happening is, in YOLO, you are dividing an image into a grid of, let's say, n by n planes. You can use it as like 8 by 8 or 13 by 13 as per your requirement, or as per the pixels of the image cannot be destroyed while like preserving the image. So I'll just go upon it. So what happens is that in this the leftmost picture, each grid is seen as a different image, right? And then a window, you can see it as like a sliding window is applied on each frame of the image, and then the window keeps on doing the regression problem rather than classification problem. So what happens is if there are two kind of position you can see in it. One is the negative position and second is the positive position. So negative position is that the object is recognized different from the ground truth. Like the predicted object is different and the ground truth is different. This we are discussing when we are training our YOLO model. So for every positive position, that means where the object is, the predicted object is similar to the ground truth, the network predicts regression on each bounding box to get its dimension and position, whereas in earlier models it was seen as a classification. So what happens, let's say that we have been we are done with the regression bounding box, and now the model gets trained to predict the confidence score on the final predicted bounding boxes. Yeah, so basically it's not much different from the faster CNN. The only thing that makes it different is classification and regression. The problem with faster RCNN is it takes a lot of time, because it has to classify each bounding box. So that process is very longer, and it generally does not give accurate results. But this training, the training of YOLO is actually pretty easier. How I have described the steps, and we'll go it through one by one. So first, what we do is we'll take some pre-trained vectors or embeddings of classifiers like VGG net or inception net, which can behave as an object detector. Okay. Next, what we are doing is we are sliding the each window on the frame, on the bounding box, and then let's say that we have 1000 categories of this bounding box. So what happens when we do like such kind of prediction is each category will have its own score. Like let's say we have cat, dog and elephant. So if there is cat detected in that bounding box, we will have the probability of cat much more than we have the probability of dog and elephant. So what we will, what this algorithm will do is it will eliminate all the categories whose probability is much lesser. It will only give the category which has the most certainty or much more higher confidence score than the other ones. Yeah. So let's get it here. So in this you can see the leftmost image is when we are dividing the picture, or when we are doing the pre-processing and dividing it into various cells or matrices, you can say. Then what is happening is each matrix is doing regression on each bounding box, and that is being predicted by two things. One is the prediction of category, second is the confidence score. So the higher is the confidence score for a category, the thicker bounding box will be formed around it to prove the certainty. You can see on the right hand side above picture, the dog has much more thicker bounding box back, and the cycle also has much more thicker bounding box rather than the other ones, which in that area there is as such object is being recognized. In the below image you can see it like as pixel wise, like in the green area there isn't much, in the green area the category classified is one, in the pink area there is another category being classified, and in the yellow area there is another category. So so what we do at the end is we combine the confidence score and the class prediction score. So to get the probability of a bounding box that contains a specific type of object. So this we can do, we can see that the images, the below image has been done by that only, and the category can be, it's generally in the number form. Like let's say you have been labeled dog as one or bicycle as two, and the predicted probability is like let's say one has 0.9, so it will be combined in the so it will be given the category of dog. And so like it's labeled differently, different people use different things to label it. Generally the outcome is same, and it's really easy to do this rather than trying or training the faster RCNN. This is just another example of YOLO training. In this what's being done is rather than creating a regression on the whole image, it's detecting just two parts of the bounding, it's just creating two parts by constructing feature map. So what feature map does is that let's say that we need to divide an object into its category. So the feature map will form the bounding box only around the area the object has been detected. So then we can the feature map can be created in a larger dimension in at the initial position, but later it can be either expanded or compact. Like in this picture we are converting it 8x8 feature map into 4x4 feature map to like compact it, but the results remain the same. So this is like speciality of YOLO, that even if you are decreasing or increasing the size of the feature map, the results are not being affected that much. As in other algorithms like Haar cascade classifier or faster RCNN, the quality affects the result a lot. So this is also one of the very specialties of YOLO. So this is like network design of YOLO. So YOLO is like a convolutional neural network, and it has, I think it's not readable that much. So this is like convolutional neural network architecture for YOLO. So this has like all kind of max pool, convolutional layer, and much more than it looks like now. So this is very exciting. So these are the results. These are the like results that are being trained on YOLO. So this is like a CCTV footage of a car that's being moved. So you can actually see that how fastly YOLO is able to detect the objects in the video. This is a GIF. So so basically what YOLO does is it processes 45 preframes per second very accurately. This is like one of the best results that can be, that has not been given by any algorithm so far. Yeah, so the advantages of YOLO over other algorithms. I've already talked about the speed. It's very fast and feasible to implement in real time. We are already using it at workplace, and it's been really helpful. So what it does is it processes 45 frames per second for extremely accurate results and 155 frames per second for lesser accurate results. So it's always a trade-off of time and accuracy, as we know in machine learning. So yeah, if you need like much more faster results but maybe a little less accurate, so you can use that YOLO. It's known as tiny YOLO, and it's often applied in you must be using the apps, right? So yeah, it's mainly used in apps so that it can do the fast processing, but results a little bit 1 or 2% here is okay. So second is that it's open source, which a lot of other algorithms and libraries are not of that are related to object detection. So third is when we are using faster RCNN or maybe other object detection algorithms, they do not take the whole image into consideration while training of the algorithm and testing as well. As I have told you, it is seen as a regression problem for the YOLO. So it covers the whole picture of a video or the whole image in like very small frames, whereas other classifiers do not do that, and that is why they sometimes miss out on the details or the appearances of different objects, and often do not categorize them or maybe categorize them inaccurately. So one of the thing that I really like about YOLO is that it learns the generalized representation of objects. When we are training other algorithms, they most of the time they start overfitting. So in machine learning, overfitting is an error which occurs when the model learns very complex details which should not be learned, or maybe it learns the noise that is not really necessary. So how does it avoid that overfitting is that it only learns the so Yeah, it only learns the last pooling layer, which is not made for learning the complex or the noise of the other images or the video. So this is why actually YOLO is being used much more than other deep learning architectures. So yeah, apart from that, its design and architecture is made like that, that it can be implemented in real time, and the end-to-end training and testing can be done fastly with very high precision. So basically, this is one of the things that I am really, really excited to talk about. So object detection has a lot of other applications, but I want to discuss about the human detection problem. This is like a subpart of object detection, and we are using it our work, it at our workplace, and this is very interesting. So the first application I want to talk is that in Google Maps, we often see that, you know, we always search about a market or a place or maybe a restaurant or any other thing, and it gives us suggestions like, you know, if you're scheduling a table booking for Tuesday, maybe you should Tuesday night, maybe you shouldn't do that because it might be really crowded. So this has been doing like really with machine learning and with the human help also. So this, what this human detection can do, this, it can completely automate that process without any human involvement. So what you can do is you can place a CCTV camera in a restaurant or a place or a market, wherever you want to detect it, and you can use this object detection training to know at what timings or at what days that place is busiest. So you can suggest people to either change their timing, or you can let them know in advance that, you know, this place is going to be full on Friday night. So if you can change, if you want to avoid that crowd, you might, you know, even change that, like your schedule or appointment. So this is being done by a heat map. So for every minute, every day, the heat map is being generated by this algorithm, like the human detection algorithm. It detects human at a particular place, and then the red in the on the right graph signifies the number of humans. It will be different for different time, it will be different for different days. So by like such places, you can avoid a crowdy, or maybe if you want to go and, you know, have party, you can just go that, okay, Friday nights this club or restaurant is very chill. So yeah, this application is like being used by many restaurants and markets these days. So second application that we are using at our workplace is for surveillance. So we know that a lot of robbery and theft activities happen in like banks or government offices or stores. So by using this application, you can detect the abnormal activities done by humans at different locations. So what we are doing is that at my workplace, that a lot of things were being stolen. So, and using the CCTV footage, you cannot actually predict or maybe get the face or some other features of the person who is doing that. So we were actually able to catch somebody using this. So I think this is very beneficial for especially the places where the chances of theft is very high. So the third this is like an advanced application of human detection. What you can, so in this we are to detect the motion of the moving object. So using this methodology, we can have an idea with which speed the object or the human is moving in the video. Like it can work as a rough estimator of speedometer also. This is mainly used by insurance companies to actually know if the truck or the car were exceeding their speeds, or maybe by traffic ticketing agencies to cut the ticket off the people who are exceeding the limits. So yeah, this is one of the really advanced applications. I have not seen much usage of this, but I think in future we will be able to see a lot of this, like automated motion detection. So this is the last and very advanced application of human detection. I am actually not sure if it's ethically right or wrong, but yeah. So in general, we categorize gender into two categories. One is male and second is female. So in this, this technique can be used to classify the genders, and this can be used in gatherings like conferences, colleges and workplaces to check if they are a gender diverse organization or not. So this has been used by Microsoft and other IBM companies, but it has not given much of accuracy, and it also has actually attracted a lot of controversies. If you are related to data science field, you must have seen that one machine algorithm was biased, and it was only able to detect the faces of white people and not the black people. So this was actually one of the sub part of the application. So yeah, I think if used in a right way, this can actually be very, very beneficial. But yeah, there are always biases and wrong prejudices that this algorithm can actually develop. Considering that we have not a biased data set, I think this will be able to catch a lot of attention and will be proved very useful. Yeah, so I that was it from my side. I'll be taking questions. Thank you guys. Yeah.
Is it from padding the convolutional layer, or is there some kind of pixelated extrapolation?
Are you talking about the bounding boxes?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what happens is this is like convolutional neural networks application. So what it does is it is already the pre-trained weights are being used, right? So let's say that what does it mean is that a deep learning architecture has already been trained on a lot of cars, and it's able to detect most of the cars. Then only it's able to make a bounding box around the shape which looks like a car to it. That's basically done in machine learning, but I'm talking mainly about deep learning. So we are just using the pre-trained weights. So there are two methodologies that you can use. One is you can train your own YOLO network. It takes a lot of memory, it takes a lot of data, but you can definitely do it. So what's the preferred way of using YOLO is that you already have a pre-trained vectors of a deep learning architecture, and then you change the hyperparameters, or maybe you try to remove the last layer, or you try adding a max pool layer, because what happens in pre-trained vectors is that it has already learned generalized features of 1,000 categories of objects. So that's one way to do that. And the other way is you can train your own YOLO from scratch. I think the bounding boxes that are being used from pre-trained gives us better results because there is already lot of training done by lot of good researchers. So while you're training your own YOLO, it might take a lot of time, it might take a lot of effort, and it might not be worth it yet. Yeah, right. Like, I think it's the right way. Like, there might be another cases when it does not give that much good results as training a scratch YOLO. But yeah, for most of the things that I have used, that's the best methodology, I think. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so basically, I get your question. So in this, so what happens is the complexity keeps increasing. Like even in this picture, you can see the cat and the duck is really small. And there might be pictures when it's even smaller than that. Then I think most of the existing algorithms surely miss it. But YOLO might miss it or not miss it, given the if the picture has high quality, I guess, or not. So yeah, that's one way that the picture should be like in HD quality, or maybe the object is like the representation matters a lot. So yeah, I think YOLO might be able to detect it, where I'm sure other algorithms might not be. So YOLO actually has like 2 version and 3 version also, but I have not worked on them, so I'll not be able to tell what are the details inside it. But I think, yeah, if you'll try, most of the time it will be able to detect. Yeah. Yeah, I think we are done. Thank you so much, guys.